Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. He is definitely worthy of it all. Let's just take away the distractions, anything that may have your attention. Let's give it all. Let's give it all for this song. He's worthy of it all.
Before the Lamb of God and sing.
you're worthy.
Yes.
You're worthy of it all.
Worthy of it all. Amen. When I think of Mother's Day, probably the greatest of all times we honor her, but we do not worship her, is Mary, the mother of Jesus. She gave instructions to the attendants at the feast of Cana in Galilee that if you'll follow those instructions, your life will just be amazing. And she said it in one sentence. How many knows moms can say a lot in one sentence? Here's what she said. Are you ready? Speaking of Jesus, whatever he says, do it. Won't that change your life? And so I'm so honored to be here this morning. And were it not for the ministry of my mom, to me, and my family personally, and to so many others that are here, this church would not exist. Her and Dad together labored to found this work, and I'm really honored that I was brought up in the Bible. I'm telling you, you did not miss Bible family devotions in the Merle household. You were in trouble if you did. And not only that, but I know what it is to be a rotten teenager out misbehaving, come home and hear your mama praying for you. That doesn't sit well when you're trying to misbehave. And then I'd remember verses like, for this cause cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. But she taught me not just out of fear, but how to love God. And not by just word, but by example. There's another mom I want to honor this morning, and she's the mother to my five children. And I've never seen much better example than Tammy Merle has been. Not just to my kids, but others, others that call her mom. A son called today from on top of a power pole to wish her a happy Mother's Day. He's at work. And I said, son, what would you rate mom on a scale of 1 to 10? And he didn't hesitate. He said, 12. So I'm bragging this morning, okay? Usually I tell you about my faults and failures, but I just want to say, if you have a mama that's alive, honor her. And isn't it awesome that West Virginia can claim this beautiful holiday? That it was founded right over in Grafton, not far from here. And a lot of things we see on the news about West Virginia we'd rather not see, but how many know, like Nazareth, good things can come from West Virginia. I don't want you to forget this afternoon, if you love Southern Gospel music or gospel choir, both will be here at 2 o'clock, be a good thing to take mom to and then buy her dinner afterwards. So I just want to remind you of that. The Southern Gospel Quartet, the Gospel Harmony Boys, they're award-winning quartet. They're very good with their harmony. And then the Lamplighters Choir of Waynesburg University. So I wanted to talk to you about that this morning and announce that, so you would know about it for sure. We've never had the Strawberry Festival gospel sing on Mother's Day. So I don't know how that's going to work. We'll just see, won't we? But let's turn our attention to the scriptures. And before we do, Dr. Curtis, would you come up and lead us in prayer for the ministry of the word?
Let's pray. Father, we're so thankful for the presence of the Lord here this morning. Lord, in your presence is fullness of joy. And Lord, this is a joyful occasion. And so, Lord, we celebrate all the mothers today. But Lord, we celebrate mostly the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for the remission of our sins. And Lord, we're so thankful for all that you've done. From then until now and forever. And Lord, we ask God that you would anoint as usual in a special way, Lord, our pastor this morning as he brings forth the word. And Lord, I pray that hearts would receive every word and soak it in like a sponge, Lord, so that we can be strengthened, so that we can be better equipped for service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. If you would, open your Bibles to Matthew, the 15th chapter. We're going to begin at verse 21. And I just want to talk to you about a mother's persistence. Moms, don't ever give up on your kids and grandkids. And you don't. And what a beautiful story we find here about it. As this story opens, Jesus is going over into Gentile territory. Tyre and Sidon. When we were in Israel, they pointed out to us that the cities that Jesus cursed, Bethsaida, Capernaum, and different ones, they don't exist anymore. They're not there because they rejected him and his message. But he said it would be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon than it would be those cities. Guess which two cities still exist? Tyre and Sidon. I just wanted you to know that when Jesus says something, you can count on it. Now, I want to give you a little bit of a background on this because we are at the time when Jesus comes first to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Salvation is first to the Jewish people because of Moses and the commandments and the promises that God made to Abraham. And Jewish people were supposed to then spread it to the entire world. And so he comes first to his own, John says in the first chapter of John, and his own received him not, but as many as did receive him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. And so Jesus' ministry has been mostly to the Jewish people, and because of that, how many religious people get a little self-righteous and arrogant? And so they kind of look down on the Gentiles. Rather than bringing the message of the commandments and the law of God to the Gentiles, they look down on them with disdain and called them dogs. Now, why am I saying that? Because I want you to understand the context of this story. A Syrophoenician woman is how Mark describes her. The writer of Matthew, he goes back all the way to the origins and calls her a Canaanite, a woman of Cana, approaches Jesus because she wants a miracle for her daughter. And that's where we'll take up the story. Then Jesus went out from there and departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from that region and cried to him, saying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, son of David." She's saying, "I know you're the Messiah. My daughter is severely demon-possessed." And he answered her not a word. His disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away. She cries out after us." But he answered and said, "I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Then she came and worshiped him. I want to read that again. She came and worshiped him, saying, "Lord, help me." Jesus answered and said, looking around at the Jewish congregation, "It's not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, but even those little dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." Now, I want you to understand something. Jesus is not calling her a dog, but he is looking at the Pharisees saying, this is what you think about this lady, but I want to show you what I think about her. And when she said that, listen to what Jesus said next. O woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire. And her daughter was healed, delivered, and set free from that very hour. Now, Jesus had a reason for doing it this way. He was showing the Jews that great faith is not limited to one people, but in every nation, those who honor God are accepted. Matter of fact, the only two times Jesus used the term great faith was both times he was addressing Gentiles who came to him for a miracle on behalf of somebody other than themselves. And the other one was the centurion. Do you remember that story? And so I want you to see what he's doing here, but I want to just kind of break this down for a minute. First thing she did is recognize him as Lord and Messiah, Jesus, Son of David. Moms that love their kids and want to see their kids saved and delivered always recognize the Lordship of Jesus. They recognize the deity of Jesus, and they realize that coming into his presence is with praise and thanksgiving. And the first thing she does is saying, I know you're Lord. I know you're Messiah. And not only that, I know you can do this. Amen. Next thing she does is enlist intercessors. They're not willing intercessors, but they're intercessors. Everybody she knows that knows him, she gets their attention and says, you go to Jesus for me. Are there any moms in the house? You don't just pray for your kids yourself, but you know that that sister loves the Lord, and that brother loves the Lord, and that disciple loves the Lord, and you ask others, would you agree with me in prayer for my kids? Because there's power in the prayer of agreement. The disciples are like, Lord, I want to tell you something. Sometimes church people get tired of hearing the same request. Huh? Like the disciples did. Oh, there she is again. Same old request. If it's your kid, you're going to be the same way. And I just love her persistence here. So she enlisted intercessors. She goes to those who know him personally. She says, I know that's brother. I know that's the apostle or the disciple Peter. That's the disciple John. That's Barnabas. They know him. I'm going to them. Hey, he didn't listen to me. Would you go get his attention? But how many knows he heard her the first time, but he's teaching a lesson? The next thing I want you to see is he seemed to be silent, but she worshiped him anyway. Hallelujah. Have you ever cried out from time to time for a miracle from God and Jesus was silent? Silence is not a no. Are you hearing me? Silence doesn't mean that he doesn't hear. I tell you what, he has a reason. Our reverence, our worship, our persistence continues. There's a story in the Bible about a widow, and there's this unjust judge, and she keeps going to him continually. And Jesus said because of her persistence, she got her answer. And if an unjust judge will answer because of persistence, grandma, don't give up. Grandpa, don't give up. Parents, don't give up. All of you, don't give up on your loved ones. Continue to intercede for them. Hallelujah. I don't know where her daughter was, but she obviously wasn't in any condition for mama to bring her with her. But it don't matter where you are. When Jesus says, it's enough, it's enough. And when Jesus spoke deliverance, she probably came hunting for mama because something changed. She, number one, goes to him, recognizes his lordship. Secondly, she enlists intercessors when she doesn't seem to get an answer. Thirdly, she worships anyway in spite of his silence. Lord, help me, she says. And then when he did speak, his words seemed harsh. And he uses the term little dog. And he's reflecting, I want you to get this because it's important. He's reflecting the attitude of his Jewish listeners in order to show them how great her faith is. Here's what you think of her. It's not me to take the children's bread and give it to the little dogs. And they're like, that's what we thought of her. But Jesus knew what he was going to do from the start. And he knew what her reply would be. She said, yes, Lord. But even the little dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from the master's table. Now, this is revelation and humility. First of all, she's recognizing that even though I'm pushed away, I treasure your words. I value every crumb that I can get a hold of. If I'm listening from the edge of the crowd, I'm still feeding on your words. Your words are life to me. And because of your words, I know you can bring deliverance. I know you can answer this prayer. Amen. Woo! Anybody value the Word of God? Even when God seems silent, you know what? He always speaks through His Word. And if you have the Holy Spirit within you, even when the heavens seem like brass, quit looking up and start reaching inward, because greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. And even when He is silent, treasure His Word. Lord, every crumb I can get that falls from the master's table, I want it, Lord. I receive it. Now think about this. She's come to him for a miracle, and his words seem harsh. I've been seeking God for miracles for my kids from time to time, and when I get a word from God, it's telling me to straighten up instead of what I want to hear. Do I walk away then? Listen to me. Don't walk away from the Lord when you want to be comforted and he reproves you, because it's worth hanging around for your miracle. He may be conditioning you to receive your miracle. See, I've come to God at times. I'm saying, God, I really need you to do this for me and do that for me. And God's saying, well, I need you to do this, this, and that. And you need to straighten up. And I'm like, not what I want to hear. I want to tell God how rotten some of you all are. Instead, he tells me I need to fix myself. I love it. His words seem harsh, but she doesn't walk away offended. She's obviously one that's persistent enough that she's not going to get her feelings hurt. She's going to hang out and see what God will do for her. And her humility is remarkable. I think about when Jesus is silent and he's not answering her, and she's enlisted the others to help, and she's told the disciples to get his attention, and all she hears is silence. I think of Job. You know what got Job through? You know what got him through? The Word of God. It wasn't just how he felt, because if it was how he felt, he'd have given up. But I want you to see what brought him through the silence and the trial that he walked through. Job 23, 8 through 12, I go forward, he's not there. I go backwards, I cannot perceive him. Anybody feel that way? When he works on my left, I can't behold him. When he turns to the right, I can't see him. But he knows the way I take. When he's tested me, I shall come forth as gold. My foot has held fast to his steps. I have kept his way and not turned aside. Looky here. Here's what brought him through. I have not departed from the commandment of his lips. I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. I love the crumbs. Even the crumbs. I'll fall from the master's table. See, Pam, I didn't even tell you I was using this text, and you already chose for the altar song, even when I can't see it, he's working. Even when I can't feel it, he's working. From the very scripture I've used here, her humility is remarkable. But aren't you glad it doesn't end there? Last thing I want you to see is not only did she receive her answer, but because of her persistence, her worship, her faith, and her love for his word, not only did he answer her prayer, but he praised her publicly. Isn't that incredible? Hallelujah. Did you know when you continue to praise Him and you continue to honor Him and you're persistent in your walk, that He'll do just like He did with His first only begotten Son? He'll say, "That's my girl. I'm proud of her. That's my son in whom I'm well pleased." Won't He do it? This is remarkable. So, don't you dare give up in your persistence and believing God for those that you love. I know this is talking about a mom, but how many know there are dads in here that are persistent in prayer? There are friends and loved ones that you have somebody you're concerned about right now. I'm telling you, it pays to be persistent and not to ever give up. I want to recap this. When you're praying for your children or grandchildren or loved ones who are under satanic influence, how many know satanic influence is rampant today? In every way, TikTok, internet, I don't even know where all to name, but it's just everywhere. It's in our schools. It's in our courthouses. Somebody's got to stand true to the gospel and be faithful to the Word of God and say, "God, I believe You can set my granddaughter, my grandson, my child free, and I'm going to keep believing." Okay, I'm going to give it to you what she did. A, she comes to Jesus praising Him and honoring His lordship. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving, amen, and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him. Bless His name. Secondly, she enlists other intercessors who know Him personally. She gets all the disciples to say, "Do something for her, Lord. She's driving us crazy." Thirdly, she persists when the Lord is silent. Keep on even when you don't hear His voice. Fourthly, D, worship Him even when His word seems harsh. Don't leave mad. Say, "God, thank You. You love me enough to point this out to me." Because He could be getting you in a position to receive your answer to prayer. And I was asking God one time, "Lord, why am I not getting the answer?" And I saw this little flash vision. I don't even understand it. I don't know a lot about football. But I saw a quarterback pull the ball back and say, "Get in a position to receive." Amen. How many know God can't give you things if you're not ready for it? And so whenever His word seems harsh, receive His word and ask Him to help you with it. Don't get offended. She could have got offended. She could have walked away and said, "Well, that Jewish rabbi called me a dog. I'll never have any more to do with him." And you know what? Her child would have never been delivered. Because He wasn't really calling her that. He was reflecting the attitude of those around Him to show them something. You've got to understand that Jesus is not rude. Amen. And then worship Him even when His word seems harsh, and then tell Him how much you treasure His word. "Lord, that's okay. Say whatever you want to me, but I'm going to treasure every crumb that falls from the Master's table." That is the faith and the persistence of a mother's prayer. I was a little boy. My mom read me a story. I'll never forget it. But it was back in the days of oil lamps, before everybody had electricity. And a little girl is sitting on her mama's lap, talking to her mom, and she looks down at her mother's hands, and she said, "Mommy, why are your hands so ugly? They're not pretty like other mama's hands." Mama said, "I have a story to tell you, honey." She said, "When you was a baby, I went next door to the neighbors to borrow something, and the cat knocked the kerosene lamp off the stand, and the curtains and the room you were in burst into flames. I rushed right back, but flames were engulfing that room, but I fought those flames. I tried to extinguish those flames until I got you, and I got you out of that crib, and I rushed out of the house. My hands were forever scarred, but I saved my baby's life." Tears ran down the little girl's face, and she said, "Mommy," she kissed her hands, "those are the most beautiful hands in the world. There's nothing more beautiful than the hands of the mother, only one other thing. One of these days, when we stand before the throne and he stretches out his hands to us and we see the scars on his hands where he saved our souls, those will be the most beautiful hands in all eternity. Would you stand with me? Hallelujah. This altar is open. If you're here with your mama today and you've never gotten saved, what a beautiful Mother's Day present for her to see you giving your life to Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Somebody give him a praise.
Since I'm back here at the piano, I'll ask you elders, if you see folks at the altar need somebody to pray with them, move out and mind the Holy Spirit.
Touch.
can see it, you work.
That's what Job said.
Even when I can't feel it, you work. You never stop, you never stop work. You never stop, you never stop work. Even when I can't see it, you work. And even when I can't feel it, you work. You never stop, you never stop work. You never stop.
Something different right here. Just feel the Holy Spirit. I want you to share with somebody near you, even if you don't know them, a name of a loved one that you're praying for. And ask them, will you help me to intercede? And then we're going to spend a little time in prayer while they sing this again. Even when you can't see it or feel it, he's working. Go ahead. Don't have to give details. Just pray for them with me. Let's pray. Jesus.
Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when stop, never stop.